number of students registering with faculty was steadily increased from year to year. Moreover, at that time, Urbino was only a 3-hour direct train journey away from Rome. Today, it's not. Today, the flight was stopped. Anyway, he had already been in Rome for 4 years. His preferred subject was civil law. It was complicated for him to begin. According to Michael Gardner, in his anonymously published connection page, his wife page was invented by only 3 years. Then he used first in the Albergo Italia, then moved to the more modest pensione at Catania. The former hotel still exists, and is next to the theater, less than 100 meters away from the faculty of the school, on the way to the school. The Castania at Catania, where the ex pensione would have been located, is just outside the walls at the entrance to the school. There is now a bus terminal and a park, but this used to be the site for the main market. Still more interesting and interesting guest is a photograph showing Nerik with 5 student colleagues on a car to Urbino 1912. All of them are clearly shoes and hats, if not also supporting the moustache, like this. The barely legible signature at the top of the front folio of Nerik's thesis, subtitle, is by the ordinance of the full-time professor of civil law, Rivka Fadler, who also was but what is possibly more interesting is the fact that Urbino had a new professor of Franca Civile, who is the subject of Mizzi's chosen research for his students also related. As we shall see, this is a century of contemporary journalistic freedom and practice, and contractually employability for others. His name was Ruggiero Lussac, who first went up to Urbino in the academic year 1910-11 and stayed there until 1921. Professor Lussac only been described as Dottoressa Anna Maria Domago of Urbino, co-editor of the prestigious journal Studi Ordinati di Scienze Giuridiche, Politiche ed Economiche, as studioso, scivo e appassionato che non volle mai esercitare la professione di avvocato, neppure come consulente o altro, per poter dedicare le proprie forze alla scuola e a una lunga attività scientifica e che ha lasciato lavori giuridici importanti e originali. Another Urbino don who would have a later resonance was Professor Francesco Ercole, who taught philosophia del diritto and storia del diritto italiano. He could well have been still more of a kindred spirit for Mr. Dominic at the time when Enrico Corradini's Partito Nazionalista Italiano was starting out, and Mizzi was undoubtedly close to it and much involved in the story Cinderella Nazionale. In 1928, Ercole would publish in Rome Dal Nazionalismo al Fascismo, on the transition from liberal to indigenous nationalism, a tormented, supposed revolutionary changeover which many people at the time lived through or were for. Some years later, he would be named to head the education unit. In the 30s, this Accademico d'Italia became president of the Regia Deputazione per la Storia di Malta, housed Palazzo Arci Mattei in Rome throughout that time. It was this deputazione which, apart from other activities, would commission in 1939 Agostino Fabelli, Storia di Malta, which Professor Ercole would personally present to Duce in April 1943, accompanied by the author Fabelli and the publisher Pierfranco Zardini, Direttore dell'Istituto per gli Studi di Politica Internazionale. Colleagues at Urbino were intrigued by the slogan "Resistere, resistere, resistere," to which I have referred in my lecture as the Nerik motto. From some research undertaken as a consequence by Professor Rosso Acuna and Dottoressa Marina Cruz, that this Mizzi's exhortation in Malta intended against discrimination and colonialism owed authority to a one-time law professor at Rome, who became prime minister at about the same time that Nerik was confined to a cell in the military barracks at Vella after his court martial for elder education. His name was volta dei libri. Resistere. Rather than that, what is time, or Mizzi's choice of easy subject, believing the implications for journalism and journalism in the light of changing technologies and expectations. Comprehensive legislation was required, he held, to regulate journalistic work practices in the light of fluctuating doctrines and the not sufficiently well defined jurisprudence. This was the title of the as proposed in his letter to London. Impone una legge che sostanza dei rapporti fondamentali della locazione d'opera giornalistica alla situazione della dottrina e della giustizia. Through the seminal and paper Malta, Mizzi had been exposed to journalism since his very childhood, and he was very much of a publicist himself. The Associazione della Stampa and the Congresso dei Giornalisti, on whose organizing committee Mizzi himself had served in the previous year at home, had been concerned with establishing una giurisprudenza sulla radice dei diritti della nostra classe professionale. Mizzi quoted thanks to this effect from a talk at the 1908 Journalist Congress held in Berlin by Andrea Cantarucci, who chaired from the college. One relationship which very needed defining, for example, was that between owner and editor. How inviolable was a journalist's contract, and what exactly determined how or why it could be extended or terminated? Mizzi's preoccupations as outlined in his introduction are and remain very valid. For some time, he said, journalism, even in Italy, was moving closer to industrial organization, so that now the importance of a newspaper was often determined by its profit margin. The importance of the giornale this message by the press tendency certainly did not favor modest standards. But on the other hand, a rigorous economic underpinning, even to journalism, would assure and guarantee better standards, reduce uncertainty and the less anticipation, which, yet, no longer, not even the last one, what the civil code required was an alleged speciality on practical order. It then looks critically at the existing literature and legislation on the subject, relying to a large extent, but by no means exclusively, on Philomuth's works relating to the nature of a journalistic contract, delving into the ifs and buts which could be better regulated and flow. These concern briefly the duration of a contract and its renewability or otherwise, the manner of remuneration and its implication, what distinguished definite from indefinite contractuality in journalism, and indeed, if and as appropriate, the estimate of density. Deadlines for a mutual understanding reached between the contracting party, probation, and especially how to avoid its abuse by the employer. That safeguarding the journalist includes his right to compensation. In periodo di prova, si presta assolutamente. Liberandosi così da ogni obbligo di tranquillità e mandare di esecuzione. Before terminating the journalist's contract, he would have to be